It is my honor to introduce you to one of our 2011 and 2013 Amelia Earhart Fellows. I first met Laura in the fall of 2011, and I got to participate in giving her her wings and certificates. It was at the District 10 Conference in Fort Smith, Arkansas. Laura was born in Bogota, Colombia. She graduated magna cum laude honors in aerospace engineering in 2010 from the University of Texas at Arlington, and she went directly into a PhD program. She is currently continuing at the University of Texas Arlington, studying in the Department of Mechanical and Aerospace Engineering, and will be completing her doctorate in August of 2014. She's weeks away from graduating. I want to read to you what one of her professors stated about her, and I'm going to quote this. What distinguishes Laura from a lot of high achievers is that she has a strong sense of involvement in community and service. Laura is studying space objects, detecting, tracking, identifying, and predicting their motion. She'll now tell you a little bit about herself and her research. So please join me in welcoming our 2011 and 2013 Amelia Earhart Fellow.
Thank you, Sharon, for that wonderful introduction. Hello, Zantians. I'm so happy to be here. I want to give a shout out to District 10. I don't know where you guys are. Thank you. I'm very proud to be here. I'm going to open my presentation with a video, and hopefully it will play. This video is going to show you the number of objects placed in space since 1957 with Sputnik all the way to 2011. As you can see, the number of objects has been rising for the last 40 years. And at the bottom of the graph, you will see 0, then 5,000, 10,000, 15,000, and 20,000. So it seems we have a bit of a problem. We have been putting stuff up there for the last 40 years, and we've done a pretty bad job of cleaning it up. So I'm going to give you a couple of numbers first. My presentation today is going to be part of the research, my doctoral dissertation. The official name is Modeling Estimation and Analysis of Man-Made Space Object Tracking and Identification. That's a mouthful. The unofficial name is I Track Space Junk. So much, much better name. I wish I could put that on my title of my thesis, but I can't. So I'm going to give you some numbers first to put the problem into perspective outside of the video that I've already shown you. So there are over 600,000 man-made objects currently orbiting Earth. 20,000 of those are larger than 4 inches. 600,000 are less than 4 inches. About 30% of these objects are cataloged, and what that means is that we know where the object is, we know where the object is going, and we know who the object belongs to and where it's going. That means 70% of the objects, we just kind of sort of know where they are, but we don't really know what they're doing or who they belong to. This is a really big problem. These objects are traveling 20 times faster than a bullet. And I'm sure if any of you have seen the movie Gravity, you know that this can be very deadly to Sandra Bullock or George Clooney. Aside from our very useful GPS that we all use to find our nearest Starbucks, and DirecTV, and of course we have the International Space Station and many other communications satellites from very many countries and military satellites from many countries as well. So we really have a big problem because the population of objects is growing exponentially. So you may be thinking, how did we get to this point? Why are there so many objects and why is anybody doing anything about it? So here are the factors that contribute to the number of objects in space. The first thing is rockets. Every time we put something on a rocket and we launch it, part of that rocket will fall back into the ocean, but part of it will remain in orbit forever. The second part is missions. Every time we do a mission, there's a risk that an astronaut will lose a wrench or that a piece of a solar panel would go floating. So that's a big contributing as well. The third contributor is spacecraft, whether they are active, like the International Space Station, or they're defunct, like Sputnik, which was placed in 1957 and no longer works, but they're still up there. Because when something breaks up there, you can't send somebody to clean it up, because it's very, very, very expensive. So we just leave it up there. The fourth and biggest contributor is fragmentation. And what that means is these pieces of old spacecraft are falling apart, and they're becoming debris, and that debris is very small. It can be from the size of a paint chip all the way to the size of a car. And so that's a very difficult problem to solve. In addition to the fragmentation, we have two events that have greatly contributed to the debris. There was a military Chinese experiment that destroyed a satellite into thousands of pieces in 2007. And in 2009, there was a crash between two satellites that also contributed greatly to that, the debris. So today I'm going to show you the research that I'm doing to try to help this problem. So what do? I take three sources of information. The first source of information is going to be to use mathematics and physics, which I have had my share of learning in the last 10 years of college. And I use these nasty-looking equations to describe how the object is expected to move. And I have somebody here on Earth taking measurements of that object as it's moving across the sky. And I can also use physics and math to describe how those measurements are expected to look like. So that's the third component, is actual measurements. This is a picture of the observatory, McDonnell Observatory in Texas. And from this observatory, I can actually take measurements of an object orbiting Earth. And these measurements have information about where the object is, where the object is going, what the shape and size of that object is, and what it possibly is made out of. So it can tell me if it's a piece of a rocket, or if it's a paint chip, or if it's something else, if it's an active satellite that I don't need to be tracking. So with those three sources of information, I can write a computer algorithm. And this computer algorithm extracts the information, compares the information, and gives me the best possible answer. And this right here is where I have spent the last 3 years of my life, and I wish I could show you more, but it would bore you to tears. And so I'm just gonna show you this. This is where the real work has been spent on. This is called a Kalman filter, and that's all I'm gonna tell you. But it has been it's been a lot of work, and it's been very interesting. And so we have shown that we can actually see where the object is, see where it's going, see what it's made out of, and see how big it is. And so we can catalog that object, and this can lead to decreasing the probability of more crashes, which would also decrease the probability of creating more debris. And so with that, the bigger picture I want to show you is, we have proven that this can be done in the lab. So whatever poor graduate student after me is gonna have to do it with a real object. So that's the next thing, because I'm graduating, so I'm done. I've made my contribution. So what I want you to take out of this presentation is not my thesis and not Sandra Bullock being hit by space debris. But what I want you to take out of this presentation is a contribution that you have made to this field. Because by having Amelia Earhart, you have contributed greatly to solving a big world problem. So thank you. Thank you for your support. And I just want to acknowledge again District 10 and Sharon, thank you for everything. And I am so happy to be linked to Amelia through this fellowship. It is a great honor. And again, thank you, ladies. You are wonderful. You have no idea how marvelous you are. Thank you very much.
vote the way you called it, I want you to take the vote again. Electronic equipment, we've virtually done away with that kind of rule. However, we have a division of the question. And sometimes we may need to take things out